This is the San Cristobal area of Cuba as it is looked from time immemorial. This is how it looked in October 1962. Those are Russian-made, Russian-manned ballistic missiles. Almost the entire population of the Western Hemisphere is within range of their nuclear strike capability. Today, they are gone. The story which you are about to see is the story behind that change, the story of the Cuban crisis. In 1962, the United States and the Soviet Union stand on the verge of direct military confrontation during 1 week in October. Ever since 1492, October has been an important month for the Americans. October 1962 will prove to be no exception. Columbus Day falls on a Friday. 10 days later, the United States and Russia will stand on the verge of a direct military confrontation over Cuba. It will be the most frightening week the world has known since the end of World War II. But on Columbus Day, the danger is not apparent. In the age of intercontinental missiles, crisis comes with the speed of sound. And so, in October 62, Americans are basking in the Indian summer sun in blissful ignorance. The Yankees are sweating out a seventh game thriller with the San Francisco Giants. The March of Dimes is choosing its annual poster girl. The First Lady is playing hostess to the children of the diplomats of many nations. Abroad, there are fireworks for the birth of still another new African nation, Uganda. At the Vatican, the princes of the Roman Catholic Church have gathered from around the world for their ecumenical council. Back home, Washington turns out to receive Ahmed Ben Bella, Premier of Algeria. Mr. Ben Bella's next stop will be Havana. But Cuba is not in the forefront of most Americans' thoughts during the warm fall days of mid-October 62. Not that the Cold War has been forgotten. We are firing a rocket at the moon. The Russians announced the on-target firing of a 7,500-mile missile. And for more than a year now, the Defense Department has been quietly putting together a massive program to strengthen civil defense. Special training and fallout protection analysis has been given to engineers and architects, and a nationwide shelter survey has been underway checking every possible building. Banks, stores, municipal buildings, schools, churches, even caves. Community fallout shelter space for more than 100 million people has been located. Supplies for the first 46 million spaces are already in production. Food and water drums, medical and sanitation kits, and radiological monitoring equipment. They're coming off hundreds of assembly lines and rolling out to Defense Department warehouses all over the country for distribution by local authorities. Building owners across America are contributing space for the new community fallout shelters. And the first shelter signs are beginning to go up. But most Americans aren't paying much attention to civil defense in October 62. The congressional elections are coming up and the campaign shifts into high.
I understand what you're up against, and I hope eventually it will be worked out.
In Connecticut, the state headed by Horace Seeley Brown and John Alsup would get my vote. Were I a resident.
Mr. Kennedy, too, has been touring the country. But early in October, he has returned to Washington with a cold. And behind the scenes, a major crisis is developing. Its name is Cuba. the loveliest land that human eyes have beheld. So did Columbus describe the land he thought to be a part of Asia when he discovered Cuba in 1492. Historically, Cuba and the United States had been friends. The monument to the battleship Maine in Havana had stood as a reminder of United States' help in winning Cuba's freedom in the Spanish-American War. But by October 62, that friendship is gone and the monument has been desecrated. Behind this change is the story of the betrayal of the Cuban people. It began when Fidel Castro triumphantly entered Havana in 1959 after 6 years of revolt against the dictatorship of General Batista. Castro had promised democracy and freedom. And for a time, he had appeared to most Cubans as their liberator. But at the United Nations, it had soon become apparent that Castro had sold out to Premier Khrushchev and the communists. By 1961, this policy had led to a formal break between the United States and Cuba. 1 year earlier, the Havana airport had resounded to the excitement and confusion attendant on all great occasions of state. The visitor was Soviet Deputy Premier Anastas Mikoyan. He had brought with him a $100 million trade agreement and the promise of Russian equipment and technicians to help get Cuba's economy back on its feet. And soon a stream of ships from the communist nations loaded to the Plimsoll line had steamed for Havana. But as October draws near, there is an intensification of shipping into Cuba. And disquieting rumors and reports, many from Cuban refugees, are that Khrushchev may be sending more than economic aid. Is he providing Castro with offensive military weapons? We step up our intelligence activities. Reconnaissance of the island and its approaches is increased. If offensive weapons are coming into Cuba, it threatens the security of the entire Western Hemisphere. For Cuba sits almost exactly in the middle of the Americas, astride the Panama Canal. But to act, the president needs not rumors, but facts.